Good morning. One more time to see if you're awake. Good morning. That's better. You're awake. You're awake. God has blessed us. God has been favorable. He's been kind. He's been merciful to us, all for the express purpose of not our own benefit, but the benefit of coming to this place and corporately worshiping Him in spirit and in truth. I hope that we never get to the point that we take for granted the blessings of God. I hope that we always are reminded that God has been good to us, that we've been to ourselves, and each and every breath that we take is a reminder of God's goodness and His grace and His mercy. I'm glad to see you this morning. More importantly, again, as someone in my family humorously always says, is glad to be seen. And so everything that we can do this morning to encourage each other, to hold up the bloodstained banner of Jesus Christ, we need to do it. From singing the songs that we sang, from gathering around the Lord's table, taking of the communion service, it reminds us of the sacrifice that Christ lived, to just smiling and saying hello to those who are worshiping with us in person, or even those who are with us on our live stream. Everything that we do, every breath we take, every movement we make, should be a constant reminder of the goodness and the grace of God. Those who are visiting with us, we're delighted to have you, whether in person or enjoying our live stream. Thank you for worshiping with us, especially those who every week show up, do the things that you do behind the scenes that nobody knows to help keep not only this church going, but keep the work growing. I'm personally thankful for each and every one associated with the Church of Christ here in Trent. A couple of dates I want you to keep in mind. I think the 29th is Trent ISD Fall Festival, and then I think on the 30th there's going to be a trunk or treat downtown here at Trent. And the fifth Sunday singing, I did not know we had three. So I'm going to go with Ernest on this. Take your pick. One in Anson, I think one at the Oldham Lane Church. The one that I'm promoting, because it was the only one that I knew, was in Lawn at the fifth Sunday singing. I will be attending that. I know it's the beginning of our gospel meeting. I know it's a full day, but I'm going to be going and supporting them and encouraging anyone else to go with me to Lawn. Again, I'm glad that we have multiple choices. I'm kind of like Ernest. It shows the Lord's church is alive and well. But more importantly, Trent, do you know what that shows? That shows an opportunity for us to get out and fellowship with our brothers and sisters in different locations, because we're going to invite them to come and fellowship with us. And so it's only courteous. If we invite them here, then we go and support them whenever we can. Brother Freddie Anderson and I talked this morning. He is ready to come and to preach the word. He told me specifically to let you know this morning how anxious he is to get here and to preach the word. And word has already gotten out. Continue to publicize the meeting. Those of you who are on social media, take copies of the flyers and the cards. Take a picture of that with your phone. Upload that to your social media feed. Those who are local, social media is not your thing. Take some of the cards, and as you put them in your truck, put them in your car, keep them in your pocket, as you're out and about talking to people, bring it up in the conversation. We are having a gospel revival, a gospel meeting in Trent. Brother Freddie Anderson is coming, and hand them one of the cards and invite them to be your guest. I'm told that we'll have a fellowship meal right after the Sunday service. Somebody told me last week, Brother Fumble, quit saying that we're just going to feed you, because you know that's not true. I said, but at least I know you're listening. At least I know you're listening. There will be a fellowship meal right after the service. Brother Anderson will be preaching morning service, and then Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, here, 7 o'clock in the evening. And then on Tuesday, November the 1st at 2:24 p.m., Brother Anderson will be speaking at the cafeteria in the at Trent ISD. I am working to expand this. I got a contact for the school in Sweetwater. I'm going to hold that until next year. It's kind of late now to get and engage them, but I am looking for contacts. I've got a contact at Merkle. They actually couldn't host him this year, but I've got them on the calendar for next year, and I'll get into the lesson. But what we're trying to do, Trent, I'm being deliberate and intentional about this. Every time we have something like a gospel meeting in the fall and then a spring event, I want to deliberately invite the community, but also take our speakers to them to show that the church is supporting, especially in education, we're supporting the academic mission of these schools. And anything we can do to encourage the teachers and encourage the students to stay in school, things get tough. Anything we can do as the church here in Trent, we're going to encourage students to be able to do that. Back on the calendar, opportunity to serve November the 12th at the home of Alice McManus. It's going to be from 8 a.m. till noon. I got a phone call from the preacher at the Methodist Church, and they're asking for community help as far as cleanup. I'm told that this time it may not be as much, so Richard, we might not need the roll-off dumpster. I'm not exactly sure yet, but just some stuff that needs to be hauled from her residence to the burn pile behind the school and some other things that that need to be thrown away. There's an opportunity to serve 8 o'clock till noon on November the 12th. That is a Saturday. We're inviting everybody to come out and to help. And I'm behind this 120% because this is the Trent community, not just the Methodist Church or the Church of Christ or the Baptist Church. This is an opportunity for all of us to come together and serve and just do a good work and helping an older lady who needs some things done around her house. So we encourage you to put that on your calendar, November the 12th from 8 a.m. until noon. Today I'm going to finish up because next week Brother Anderson will be here and we'll officially start the meeting. But I'm going to finish the last sermon in this series for this month, being anchored in your faith, finding assurance in the promises of God. And you remember we've been really talking about how to find hope when it comes to hopeless situations, and our faith always needs to be anchored. We need to stay rooted and grounded in God. Today, we're going to go over and look at John chapter 15, and just one word, and that one word is remain. And I'll use this interchangeably with the word abide, but really, if we're going to stay rooted and grounded in God, then we need to remain in God. We need to remain with God. And I'll tell you the premise for this before we go and read the text. You know, I'm getting a little perturbed now by churches of Christ, especially those who at one time held on to the doctrine and the teaching of the New Testament. I'm getting a little tired of us compromising the Word of God because we just feel like it. If we're really going to stay rooted and grounded in God, then we need to stay anchored in His Word. No matter what winds of denominationalism blow our way, we need to stay rooted and grounded and anchored in the Word of God. John 15:7. Jesus says, "If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves," he says, "to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this so that my joy might be or may be in you and your joy may be complete." Did you hear it in that text? All in that text, I kept hearing one word, and that is abide. Stay. Be anchored. Don't let the winds of anything sway you or pull you. Don't let storms take you away. Stay. Abide. Stay. Abide. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so thankful, Lord, for all of your blessings. And we pray, Lord, now for the message. And we pray that we are obedient to you and we stay anchored and we stay grounded and we stay rooted in your word. We acknowledge that hard times will come. We acknowledge that challenging times come, but our faith is in you. Help us never to forget that. Help us to never lose that. Help us to always allow our faith in you to sustain us so that we can continue to obey you in our everyday lives. Thank you, Lord, for all of your blessings. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Remember last week I said it like this. When it comes to the storms in your life, the adversities in your life, each and every one of us are at one of these three stations. You are either heading for a storm, you are either in the midst of a storm, or thank God if you are coming out of a storm. And hard times, like I said last week, none of us are shielded or immune from hard times. But the interesting thing for the Christian is we can face hard times and we should stay anchored because Christ in us, Colossians 1:27, is the hope of glory. When you look at John 15, the overarching theme of John chapter 15 is that word abide, stay, remain. No matter what happens, remain, abide, stay. The idea here is really that our adverse circumstances, our hard times should be used in our lives to toughen us up. It should be looked at as adversity that brings forth an inner growth. And every day and every way in our lives, we ought to grow closer and closer to Christ. Jesus used this idea of fellowship with him in John 15. He uses it an analogy of a vine and branches. And this is designed to teach the true believers. Just like that vine and those branches are interconnected, we are interconnected with Christ. When we obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, we are now connected to him, and we get our vital nutrients. Just like that vine and that branch are symbiotically connected, we get our vital nutrients from our relationship with Christ. So we ought to stay anchored in him. Any relationship, as with any relationship, growing closer is not necessarily automatic. It requires purposeful spending of time together. You keep working on this as issues come up. Anybody who's been married any great length of time will tell you, you gotta work at that relationship. You can't put that relationship on automatic pilot and expect it to grow. It's gotta be deliberate and intentional. And the main part of that relationship comes as a result of a desire to get to know and to get closer to one another. And if that doesn't come up, and if that doesn't relate as a part of the relationship of getting close, then guess what? We drift further and further apart. Three things in John 15 that I want to leave you with today and finish up this series on staying anchored in Christ. Number one, to grow closer to Christ, we have got to allow his word to abide in us. We cannot grow closer to Christ absent from his word. And this is where I'm kind of getting a little short fused with a lot of our brethren who read the same Bible as you and I read, who obey the same gospel as you and I obey, who worship hopefully the same tenets that we see in the Bible. Yet around me now, I just see all kinds of compromise for no good reason other than to appeal the masses. And I'm getting a little weary with that, to be honest with you, because if we're gonna really grow closer to Christ, no matter how bad hard times get, we ought to allow that circumstance to grow us closer for a relationship with him. To grow closer to Christ, some things we have to do, and it's not magic. It's not something that we don't already know, but it's stuff that we don't already do. We got to read our Bible over and over until we are at home with it. And that doesn't just go to the preacher or the elder or the deacon or the Bible school teacher. That goes for each and every one of us. You should have a time set aside every day where you spend some time with you and the Lord in His Word. And the only way I know to do that is to really line it up kind of like physical eating. You know, if we physically eat enough food every day to stay alive, then we ought to spiritually spend time with God and His Word to stay spiritually alive. If we live closely with Him and His Word, that closeness will, by natural connection from God, that closeness will govern our requests, and then we'll be asking and receiving answers from God on a regular basis. You remember back when we used to write letters? You remember how we used to write the letters? There was a certain format that we used to write those letters. If Junior was writing a letter home, "Dear Mom, how are you?" "I am fine. I hope that everything is well." And remember, we would go through all the flowery stuff before we got down to the end of what we really wanted. We're going to ask, "Mom, please send some more money. Thank you very much. Love your son." That should have come from a closeness. That should come as a desire for us to really want to serve God and be close to Him. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8 has been a very interesting text to me for a very long time. Joshua was given these instructions to keep this book of the law always on your lips and meditate on it day and night. Well, why do that? The answer's in the text. So that you may be careful to do everything written in it, that you will be prosperous and be successful. You ever hung around somebody that you were best friends with, or you were associated with somebody, and all of a sudden you started using their words and they started using your words? And it's almost like married couples, who've been married now for a long time. You can start the sentence and your mate would be able to finish the sentence. I got a kick, and this was years ago. I got a kick out of, I was somewhere, and we were filling out some paperwork, and my wife wasn't with me, and the lady was asking questions that she thought my wife, "Well, we better wait on your wife to come back, and we'll get her birthday." I said, "It's this right here." And she said, "Oh, well, I'm also going to need her social security number, so most men don't know that, so we'll just keep this right here." I said, "Such and such and such, such and such and such, this is this." And she was like, "Well, y'all must have been married a long time." It's not that we've been married a long time, which we had at that particular point. It's just a closeness. If you call yourself being close to somebody, there are certain things you ought to know about them. People who are close to me, well, it's changed now because the doctor has changed it, but used to, if you're close to me, you knew I was a chocoholic. Now I'm a dark chocoholic. But it used to be milk chocolate. You see, so if you're close to somebody, you know them, you know their attributes, you know how they're going to think. Guess what? That's how it should be with our relationship with Christ. We ought to be so close to our Lord. We know that if we're going through hard times, we don't know how it's going to work out, but it's going to work out. Why? Because He brought me through before, and He's going to bring me through again. Secondly, to grow closer to Christ, to abide in Christ, to stay, to be anchored in Christ, we've got to obey His commandments. And it's relatively easy to obey the word of the Lord when things are going well, isn't it? It's easy to be a Christian when things are going well. In school, we used to say, "You're a fair weather Christian. You're a Christian as long as the weather is fair." I'm like, "What? Really? Stop that." But as soon as hard times come, we do tend to let go of God's hand. The test of obedience is when He takes you through difficult trials. Now, that's a qualifier. Because what's difficult for me might not be difficult for you. See, at the end of the month, when I've got too much month left at the end of my money, that might not be your problem. Your problem might be something else, but I know God is going to sustain me. I know God is going to see me through. How do I know that? He did it before, and I know he'll do it again. At such times, you may not understand why the particular trial is happening, but we've got to do two things. That is trust, and we have got to obey. And I think that's a problem for us, especially in these modern day and time, isn't it? A lot of times we don't trust anybody but ourselves. And we don't like the word obey because I don't want nobody telling me nothing. But when it comes to my relationship with God, I have got to trust and I've got to obey. I love this text in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 17 and 18, talking about when hard times come. Paul says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what's seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen, Paul says, is temporary, and what is unseen is eternal. I can't help but go back to Genesis chapter 22, because I think this puts a good window on how we need to look at life through Isaac's eyes. You remember when Abraham took his son Isaac and he was going to sacrifice him on the altar. Now, people ask me all the time, Brother Family, you don't really believe he would have killed the boy, do you? Yes, I do. Yes, I do. And I believe his faith was of such that God was able in Abraham's mind to give him his son back. On the third day in chapter 22, you remember the text. Abraham looked up and he saw the place in the distance, and he said to the servants, stay here with the donkey while the boy and I go over here. We'll worship. And then look at this. This is why I say we will come back to you. This is why I believe Abraham would have done it and his faith would have seen him through. So Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and he placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife, and the two of them went together. And Isaac spoke up and said to his father, Father, yes, my son, Abraham replied, the fire and the wood is here, Isaac said, but where's the lamb for the burnt offering? See, the boy was no dummy. He'd done this before many, many times. He saw the fire, he saw the wood, but he didn't see the lamb. He didn't see the animal for the sacrifice. And I love Abraham's answer to him. Abraham said, son, don't worry about it. God himself will provide. You want to know how to stay anchored when you're in your desperate moments? You want to know how to stay grounded when life is at you and you got too much month left at the end of your money, or the doctor has given you a diagnosis that's not favorable? You want to know how to keep that and keep the faith that you have? Realize that God himself will provide a lamb for the burnt offering. The two of them went together. You remember what happened. Abraham put the wood and the fire up and the boy as the sacrifice. Wonder when it clicked in Isaac's mind that he was the sacrifice. Wonder when it clicked. And I wonder, we don't read where he started kicking and bucking and trying to get away. We don't read that. And I call this section Life Through Isaac's Eyes. Isaac had to look up and see that knife coming at him. Wonder what was on his mind. I would like to believe the same faith that his father had was passed on to him. You want to know how to stay anchored when it comes to the storms of your life? Stay with God's word, trust him, and obey him. Third thing, and I'll wrap this up. If we're going to stay anchored in God, we're going to grow closer to Christ. And this one's a challenge, I admit this. Then we're going to have to stay focused on God's joy, on his joy. Listen, the world can only offer joy when things are going well. It's relatively easy to be full of joy when things are going well. When you open your refrigerator and you got enough food and all the bills are paid and you got a little extra money, boy, it's easy to sing hallelujah, I praise God. But let the first hard sign of trouble come, and you'll see your true nature. I maintain, and from the Bible, I maintain that we need to be as joyous during hard times as we are when times are not so hard. You know, we need to stay full of joy in a marriage with beautiful children, satisfying, well-paying job, good health. Those are all joyous occasions, but it's only those who go through some hard times. It's only those who have been through some scrapes that God has delivered them that they can say, I know God. I rejoice in my troubles and in my tribulations. Two scriptures and then I'm done. John 15 verse 11. Remember what Jesus said. I've told you this so that my joy may be complete in you and that your joy may be complete. And I've said this before. Christians, we ought to be the most joyous people around. We ought to be the happiest people around. Does that mean we don't struggle? That we're immune from struggle? No. But if we're going to be salt and if we're going to be light, then we need to show the world how we struggle. And we need to have the right perspective. Struggle is a matter of making us better to draw us closer to Christ. 1 Peter chapter 4. And verse 13, Peter says, but rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory, manifested excellence, is revealed. What do I mean by that? Our faith in Christ needs to be so firm and so unshakable that when we're going through the difficulties of life, we need to come to grips and have a prayer like this. Lord, I don't know how you're going to work this out, but I know you're going to work this out because you've done it before and I'm waiting for you to do it again. Nothing in my life is going to take my joy away from serving my Lord. Now that's difficult. That's challenging because sometimes life can throw you some curveballs, but I want to show you an example and then I'm done. I want to show you an example of faith that you do automatically in your life every day and you don't even realize that you're acting on faith. Used to be you take a prescription that you got from a doctor, written in handwriting you couldn't read, with words and medicines you didn't know. You would take that and take it to a pharmacist. Now I think they call it in, but this will still work. You hand that to a pharmacist, and he goes or she go in the back room. You don't see what they're putting in that pill bottle. You have no clue as to what's going on. They come out, hand you pills. You still don't know what it does. They do the best to explain it to you, and guess what you do? You go home and faithfully take those pills, especially if it's an antibiotic, take it till it's all gone, not giving a thought to the faith that you just engendered. Now, where am I going with this? With the same faith that we use to fill that prescription secularly is the same faith that we need to use to say that my God will supply my every need. And when it comes to my hard circumstances in life, I am not gonna blame God. I'm not gonna blame other people. I'm gonna keep my faith in God and I'm gonna grow stronger because of what I'm going through. I'm gonna be better on the other side. You know, the invitation time is a time to come forward and to admit one thing that God already knows. Lord, I can't handle this by myself. I'm going through something right now, Lord, that I need your help. Whether you need that help in prayer, whether you have a Bible question, whatever you need, we avail ourselves to be able to serve and to be able to help and to be able to answer. If you have a prayer need, you simply come forward and say, this is what I'm needing. I need prayers, and we will pray for you. If you have a Bible question, we will answer your Bible question. If you've already come to the point in your life where you realize I've been living my life outside of the will of God, then you come to God by hearing his gospel, believing it, repenting of your sins, confessing Christ, being willing to be baptized in water for the remission of your sins, and then God will add you to his congregational family. We invite you, whatever your circumstance is, We're going to stand and we're going to sing the song of invitation. We invite you to come forward as we now get ready to stand and sing Trust and Obey.